if you're preparing to sit a Microsoft certification exam for the first time, one of the questions you've most likely got in your head is, what kind of questions am I going to get? What is this exam going to be like when I get in there? In this video, I'm going to show you inside the exam. Yes, really. A safe place and totally legitimate place provided by Microsoft that you can go in and get familiar with what that experience is going to be like, understand the kinds of questions you're likely to see on the exam, and you'll be far more at ease when you're ready to sit the real thing. Let's take a look. What you're going to do is navigate in your browser of choice to this website here, and you will find yourself in a simulation of the exam experience. The difference here is that I'm just doing this in a normal browser. When you do the exam experience for real, you will be using the Pearson View software that's been downloaded onto your machine. I've got a whole other video on that if you want to understand how that works. So just bear in mind, real exam, everything else on your system will be locked out. You can't browse to other sites or do anything. This practice experience is just running in a browser. First thing you need to do is sign the agreement, agree to the rules, understand the privacy. In the top here, you've got 5 minutes to do this. This doesn't take away from your exam time. This is a separate 5 minutes, so read that carefully. You do need to scroll all the way down to the bottom of it before the option to say that you have accepted the terms will be available to click yes and move on into the exam. Now, this is the moment where you check you are the right person in the right place. This should have the exam code that you're sitting and confirmation, you're good to go. Next. The next screen here is going to give you information about what to expect from the exam, but because you've done this awesome exercise in preparation, you're not going to need to worry too much about this part. And finally, we get a screen that's going, all right, here we go. It's about to happen. Once you press next, you are into the exam. This is the duration of the exam, and this is the number of questions that you can expect. Now, typically, it's a lot more than 10, but for our practice experience here, that's what we're going to get. Once we've launched the exam, we see in the top right here this timer telling us how much is left to go, and we can go ahead and get into the first question. Now, let me just orient you around some of the parts of the screen and the exam and how it actually works here. So in addition to that timer and that sort of progress bar across the top there of how many questions you've got, for each question, it's telling you this is question number 1 of 10. It's going to tell you, you know, progress along the way. You've got the options here to either mark something for review later or to leave feedback. And I'll show you at the end what happens when you've marked those boxes. Question itself we'll come back to. There's a help screen here which pops up some things that can help you with keyboard shortcuts and controls and so on if you need or want to be using those things. There is a calculator in there, so as much as you can't navigate out to anywhere else, if you need to do some calculations, that is available to you within the exam experience. If you prefer to work in other modes here, so let's say we want to go into that dark mode, you can do that. And reset will reset the question itself. So if you've got something where you've ticked a lot of boxes and you're just like, oh no, start again, you can click that one. And then we've got our previous and next buttons, which allow you to navigate through the questions within that section of the exam. First type of question that we get here is multiple choice with one correct answer. It's going to give you a scenario. In my experience, this is about the amount of information that I've seen here. In a power platform exam, this might be something like customer wants to achieve the following thing, and it will just describe in sort of half a sentence something that they want to do, some business requirement that they have. Which of the following options is the correct solution to recommend? The further you go up in the scale of complexity of the exams, obviously the harder these questions get. That example is a typical sort of foundations kind of level question. So we go in here and we pick the correct answer, and then we can click next to move on to the next one. Second question type, multiple choice with multiple correct answers. Now read carefully here because it will always tell you how many correct answers, in this case, which two fruits. So this might be which two components might make up the solution, or which two statements are true. Those kinds of things will come up. It will prompt you if you do too many here. So if you only click one, it will allow you to do that. But if I try to click a third one, it's going to prompt me and say that's incorrect. Let's say this is a question that I'm not sure about and I might want to come back to it later. I can mark this one for review. Highly recommend, top tip here, put in your gut feel while you're there, because just in case, you can come back at the end of the exam and review these answers. But if you run out of time, or you just get to a point where you just you can't come back to it for whatever reason, at least you've got an answer in there. You do not lose points for wrong answers. It's always worth having a guess. Even if you don't know, put something in, mark it for review, and then see how you feel at the end of the exam. You can also choose to leave feedback. So if we click in here and choose to leave feedback at the end, that's about providing Microsoft with feedback for things like this didn't make sense, the language wasn't clear, the terminology was out of date, those kinds of things. Honestly, if you're doing it for the first time, you're probably not going to be doing a whole lot of that. For those of us who are further down the path, I quite enjoy leaving a bit of feedback as we go. Now we've got question three, and this type is about drag and drop. Tip here, you can move things around the screen. So this, you can kind of shrink that area to give yourself more. If you find that these pieces over the side are longer, and often they can be because it'll be sort of more than a single word, then you can move that back and forth as well. So just be aware that that's a responsive thing that you can move around. And this one is about saying, again, a description of a scenario of some kind, and then drag and drop the correct answer from the column on the left to the options on the right. And each one can be used more than once. It's not a sort of single match this to that sort of thing. Here are the options, and just put them in the right place. So you might have some kind of technical terminology down the side here, which you're matching up to scenarios there. This can come in all sorts of different forms. So what we do here is just drag this across. So we might say, okay, well, furniture, lamp, that's definitely home. So we're going to drop that one in there. Sofa is home. So you'll see there, if I know what I'm doing with furniture, I'm using the same answer twice. That one's home. Oh, look, the ping pong table is definitely office, and so on. You can, you know, move it back out again if you think you've got it wrong, or come in and you know, move these things around and put that over the top and change it until you're happy with that. And when you're done with all of the answers there, we click through to the next one. Question type four, the build list reorder. This is about saying, put the following things in order of the steps you would take. So you typically see things here that are like, you need to build a certain thing, or you need to put together something in a solution. What is the order of the steps that you need to take? And it will tell you how many are in there again. So which five tasks should you create? And you'll notice 1, 2, 3, 4, we've got more than five in there. So this is typical that it's not just giving you the five you need, it's giving you a couple of red herrings, and you need to be able to sort them out. Now, my tip for doing this question is to first, before you even start to try and answer it, have a look, and you'll find that it's not too hard to spot the red herrings, because you'll see two things in the list where you go, oh, those two things clash, or something like that. So have a bit of a look and see if you can spot that first and narrow down which are the five. And then we're going to go on and say, all right, now we're going to put those things in. So we need to say, where am I going to start here? Put the slices of bread on the plate, I guess. And then I'm going to put some ham on top of the bread, and I might put that on there. And then I think, oh no, hang on, I've missed a couple of steps here. I certainly want to add some pickles, and I can put that in and drag that up and put it in the order. And I don't really want onions. We'll go mayo. This is I'm not sure this is the greatest sandwich in the world. So you'll see as you put things in, you can sort of draft it and put them in, and then change your mind and reorder things around. So you can actually work those things through in there. Question five, this is an active screen. So this is actually simulating the user interface, where you can click on something in the screen. So rather than answering something in words, this is giving you something far more like a real life experience of what you would be clicking on in the UI. Again, it'll say, you know, something like, which part should you click? What option should you select? And you're going to go in here. And again, you can, so you can drag this up if you need more space to see it. And then I can click on something, and it's simulating the experience of that UI there, where I can click and unclick on those things. The next question type is about completing a statement or making choices. This one is essentially some drop-down options at the bottom after the scenario has been described. It might be a full sentence where you have to complete it, or it might be a description, and then you choose which is the correct option that would be the right way to go about doing that thing. So this one's fairly self-explanatory. We're just going to choose, and I'm largely working at random here, choosing those options. That's all there is to it. Our next question type is a hot area. This is similar to what we saw before with the user interface, but instead of being an actual simulation of the user interface, this time it's actually just going to highlight something on the screen so that I can click on a certain area of the screen to show where the correct answer would be that I would select from. What we see here is an example of a case study. Now, in my experience with the real exam, the case study will actually be treated as a whole separate section. So what that means is you would actually go through the questions and it will say you finished the certain number of questions. It will take you back to the final screen and then say, now let's start the next section, which is the case study. If you've got an exam like that, where the case study is in a separate section, and in my experience of the exams I've done, it always is, it treats it as you can't then go back, and it will give you plenty of warning. It will say, you're about to complete this section, you cannot go back to it, and you're effectively kind of signing off, sealing off that section of the exam, and then you're going into the case study section and you'll do that case study, and then you'll sign and seal that one off and you can't get back into it. I've found case studies will have maybe 5 questions related to the single case study. It'll tell you how many questions there are once you're in it. You do those ones and then you package that one up and you're done. So case studies, some tips about doing case studies. This is a part of the exam that's going to take you the most time, because you really do have to take in a lot of information, think about it, interpret it. This is testing skills in a different way. And again, the higher level exams have more of these and more complex case studies than the foundation level exams, which tend not to have them in my experience. So what we've got here is the question. We've got the overview here and then some things down the side. I've seen quite a lot more than that, maybe 6 or 7 or sometimes 10 different pieces of information. So the case study can get quite deep. So the first thing we've got here is the overview. It'll give you the scenario of, here's a customer, they have this many users, this is what they're trying to achieve, and then different things down the side. Oh, here we go. When we open it out, that's more like what it looks like. So we've got information about the existing environment, and we can click through, and you know, there's quite a lot to take in here. So here's my tip for doing case study questions. It will have like 5 questions, and you can flick sort of next through the questions in the case study as you go. So I would suggest, look at the questions first, have a bit of a read through them so that you know what you're looking for. So there is a bank of questions behind the scenes relating to the whole case study, but you're only going to get a handful of them. So I like to look at it and go, which areas is it going to ask me about? And then I'm going to go in and target my reading more focused on those areas. It is always good to kind of scan through the whole thing, but if you know what questions you're going to be asked as you're reading, you're going to give yourself an easier experience with that. Practice on this question 8 if you're doing an exam that's likely to have case studies, because once you're in here, where's my question gone? There it is there to get back to it, and there it is to get back into the case study. The questions themselves in the case study are largely the same things that we've just seen, those multiple choice, select all the answers that are correct. I've seen the drag and drop, the select from the correct statement, all of those same kinds of formats. A couple of other questions here that we've got at the end, which is an exhibit question. So this one is something that is actually giving you like a visual of the screen with reference to the question. So just make sure you're clicking on that tab. Similar kind of question format that we've seen before with the multiple choice, but with reference to an exhibit, and then also a multi-exhibit question. So we've got 3 or 4 here, 3 different screenshots and things that are relating to that question. And then this is the other type of question you'll see sometimes, is a yes, no. I've also seen questions that are like, does this form a complete solution, yes or no? And a series of questions like that that go through, and you have to answer those in a section as well. What happens when you get to the end is you get this screen that says you've answered 7, you've unanswered 3. Do not leave any unanswered, like really, no matter what you do, even if you've only got 1 minute left, click through onto that and just take a guess. No points off for wrong answers, remember that. For review, this is where I can come back in and see one that I wanted to review. I can go in here and say, do you know what? I reckon that's definitely going to be an apple, and go on to the next one, and that will allow me to work through those again. And then if you've got any for comment, you actually do that after the exam. That gives you a separate, like additional 20 minutes or something after the exam to leave review comments. It doesn't take away from your exam. When you're done with that, you finish. It's like, are you sure? Are you really sure? And you can say yes. If you have offered to provide feedback, that's where you can do it. The other thing you want to make sure you've done in preparation is that you understand how to set up your room if you're doing it from home as an online proctored exam, and how to do a proper system test. I've got another whole video that takes you through that and shows you what that experience is and how to do that set up properly. So make sure you go ahead and watch that, and I'll see you in that next video.